Dalglish is in here. Yes! Albi. Oh, look at the space here now for Whelan. Dalglish is making a run for him. One player's gone tumbling. And it's played across for Rush. That's another one. And that will make it safe for Liverpool. And that will mean, without any doubt at all now, that the league and cup double will be theirs.
He is one of the best and the finest players I ever saw, and the one of the best in the history of football. And I like him very much. As a player and as a person, because he has a very, very good character, and it's always nice to be with him.
That's Kenny Dalglish making the angle for the shot. Dalglish makes it 3-1 and equals the Scottish record.
March 1986, and the city of Glasgow recognises the character and talents of Kenny Dalglish. He takes his place alongside Nelson Mandela, the boxer Jim Watt, and the Duke of Edinburgh as a freeman of his native city. He can now graze his cows and hang out his washing in the city centre. It's also an occasion for pride and memories, a celebration of the process which can transform a working-class boy into a national folk hero. That is the opportunity which football presents, and more than anyone of his generation, Kenny Dalglish has responded to the challenge. Glasgow respects its footballers, but can soon recognise gods with feet of clay. Kenneth Matheson Dalglish, freeman of the city, comes through with flying colours on all counts. His image is exemplary, his goals imprinted on the national memory. The game of football has long been a mainstay of Glasgow street culture. The city divides all too deeply between two clubs of very different identities, and Kenny Dalglish grew up as a Rangers supporter. In his early teens, his family moved to a multi-storey block of flats just a corner kick away from Ibrox Stadium and looking down on Rangers training ground. Apart from Dennis Law, all his boyhood heroes were Rangers players. Dalglish could watch at close quarters, a club he yearned to join. He became an apprentice joiner, having been advised to forget football and to concentrate on a trade, but he hoped that Rangers would notice his already outstanding football skills. At the age of 16, he wanted to play for no one else. But in one of football's great ironies, adulation from the balcony wasn't reciprocated. It was a disappointment for Kenny's family and friends that he didn't find his way into the hallowed halls of Ibrox. But his talents had been observed from another corner of the city, and soon the unthinkable happened for a lad who had been dyed in the blue wool of Rangers. In 1967, the year Celtic became the first British side to win the European Cup, Jock Stein took the young Kenny to Celtic Park. For the next 10 years, he wore the green and white with a distinction that kept Celtic's magic alive through the rebuilding period of the 70s. But the most difficult task he faced in signing for Celtic was to break the news to his father.
Although he was a Rangers supporter, he wasn't bigoted in any shape or form. And when Celtic came up, obviously at the time, Celtic had just won the European Cup. They were going great, and he said, well, if you want to learn football, that's the best place to go. When I came at first, Jockstein introduced us to Sir Robert Kelly, who was then the chairman. And all he said to me, he said, if your ambition is to go out and play in a green and white jersey, you'll do for us. And from then on, it was really just a matter of success.
Robin, Dalglish, to Dean's lovely ball. Back towards Dalglish, a great move and a great goal. A critical move, and what a goal by Kenny Dalglish.
Dixie Dean's a great one too. Dalglish!
Dean's trying to head it in. This is Jarvie trying to get it away for Aberdeen. He has it,
through the gap to the leash. We always used to report for pre-season training, and Big Jock used to invariably bring along a whole lot of kids that had just left school or just about to leave school, and in that particular time Kenny came along, and the most impressive thing about him was the fact that he could readily and easily step in and play with good accomplished players and good professionals at that time without any obvious embarrassment. It was evident to every one of us that here was a special talent.
Dalglish, beautiful goal.
Green trying to put the pressure back on. Kenny's got Murray on his right. McGrain shoves it through towards Dalglish. McGrain back to Dalglish. Dalglish flicking it in. The ball is given. Dalglish has scored.
Dalglish just did what came naturally. Scored goals, some of them marked with genius. Soon his very special talents attracted Scotland's manager.
His first cap, obviously, or his first time he appeared for me was at Pittodrie when we played in the Nations Cup, when we beat Belgium with nothing. He came on then as a substitute. But he was disappointed, obviously, in the World Cup match when he was in the squad and on the subs bench in Denmark, when we beat Denmark in the World Cup 4-1. And I promised him, I saw it in his face, that I was saving for Hampden Park for the return game with Denmark at Hampden, which he actually started the game, got his first full cap, so to speak, and he scored the goal in the 2-0 victory in that particular match, which gave us 4 points out of four, which was a marvellous start for the World Cup.
And here's the man, Peter Lorimer, with dynamite in his boots to take the corner kick. It was from a corner that Scotland scored their first goal in Copenhagen. Over it comes, it's a good one away to the far side, punched out but not cleared. Still dangerous out in front, the chance for the beast.
So he's a genius of a player. He's a credit to the game on and off the pitch. And a lot of people felt that he'd never always played well at international level. I've always felt he's always played for the team rather than for himself, which a lot of people are inclined to overlook. But you could see at that early age that he was definitely destined for stardom.
Wilson. What? Dalglish. What a goal!
Celtic won the League and Cup double in 1977, but after a decade of all the honours that the Scottish game could offer, Kenny's eyes were turning in a traditional direction. The challenge of English league football was beckoning. Jockstein tried hard to keep Dalglish at Celtic Park, but the desire to prove himself on the world's best footballing stage was all too strong.
I wanted to try and play in England and to see if I was any good, and also to see if I could succeed. If I didn't succeed, there was always a possibility that I could have come back to somewhere else in Scotland.
Liverpool's very own local hero had also developed a wanderlust.
Toshack's head, Keegan was already on the move into the box, and he's got it over the keeper's head!
Kevin Keegan was heading off to his own new challenge in West Germany. At Anfield, Bob Paisley already had a replacement in mind.
Well, we knew him. We'd seen him playing in the international and that, and we knew all about him. And when, as I say, when they came, and when Sean had came, and when Jock said that he wasn't able to keep him and that, and then we had no hesitation.
Well, funny thing about Kenny Dalglish in Anfield, he was here as a 15-year-old boy, you know. He came on trial as a schoolboy with a crowd of other lads, had his trial and then went home. And it was only later on that Shankly realised that Dalglish had been here as a boy and he went mad. How did we, you know, miss him?
Dalglish signed for £440,000, a British record. And so he joined a long list of Scots who had earned devotion in a city rich in legends.
When you walk through a storm, hold your head up high and don't be of the dark. At the end of a storm, there's a golden sky and the sweet.
They just won the European Cup, but it hadn't made any difference to them. They weren't affected by it. They were still ambitious and greedy to win more things. And really, that was the most impressive thing that I found when I came here first, and how friendly the place was.
Walk on through the wind. Walk on through the rain. For your dreams beat us and blow.
I don't think anybody thought I was a replacement for Kevin Keegan. And as much as they didn't think I was a carbon copy of Kevin Keegan, I came here with the train of thought that I was going to try my best and just hope that it'd be good enough.
I think he chose the right moment to come to England. He had given Celtic a whole lot of service, a whole lot of good service, and he left as a good experienced international player. So when he came down here, there was no doubt that he could cope with whatever pressures were on him. And obviously coming down for such a high transfer fee in those days, although if you analyse it, it was really for peanuts, I think he was able to cope with all the pressures and all the demands of the media down here. And plus the fact, when I look back, I think he was the only person that Liverpool could have replaced Keegan with.
I said to some Liverpool supporters before he played, I said, I tell you what, this guy is 10 times the player that Keegan was and is and will ever be. And of course, his first league game was against Middlesbrough, up in Middlesbrough, which, you know, it's not the best of places. It's very cold, even in the summer. And Kenny came on the pitch. Of course, everybody's eyes is on him. And then he scored after 6 minutes. And still not Peter Jones and said, well, you know, that's got to be the first of many. And Liverpool fans will, you know, if Kenny Dalglish and the rest of the team go on, they'll win everything. Of course, which they did.
Little Kevin was a buzzy, race-around little player, always looking to get on the end of knockdowns from Big Toshack, who was playing at the time, a wholehearted little player. But I always felt like a player who got better as you got older, because he was a manufactured player, if you like, one that had to work very hard. But Dalglish had the football brain, you know, the thing that Shanks always talked about, a bit of craft, a bit of cunning. You know, the old Scottish inside-forward stuff, he had that. Now, you can't give that to people. They've got it, it's an inherent talent. And he had that talent. And the fans at the club here love that, because they like to see somebody that's a little bit different, you know, that can turn and do a little reverse passes, you know, get defenders all over the place. And immediately they saw Dalglish playing here, and everybody took to him.
They're a different type. And I would have taken him even had Kevin been here. So it was a bonus that we did get him when we did, but I would certainly have taken him. And look how lucky I would have been then. I might have won something then.
Splendidly executed.
This hit, but it's Van Dalglish, and he turns and scores. In by Highway. And the chest down by Perriman dropped nicely for Dalglish, and now Kennedy. And Souness, can he turn on it? Pulled it back for Case. Dalglish!
It's Highway with the corner. And surely, well, eventually Dalglish has got it. Case. And Dalglish is in the clear. And Dalglish slots in a super little goal. Oh, so easy.
Is back heel, and that's got Neil in, and Neil will score. What a glorious goal that was. Hansen is up there, this is McDermott, and he's onside, and Hansen scores.
Oh, what a lovely goal by McDermott.
Johnston. And now Rush, and Johnston. We'll be right back.
any man who can score 100 goals for Celtic north of the border, where we're apt to think that goals come maybe a little bit easier than they do down in the south, we think that, and then score 100 goals in the English First Division, he's just magnificent footballer. He's the best thing I've ever seen in a red shirt of Liverpool.
There are all kinds of dangers here. The kick's been quickly taken to Cohen. And Cohen tries to chip the goalkeeper and hits the bar. Lee Dalglish, it's 3-0. Dalglish, he's wriggled round McIlroy, he's lost Buchan, he's got a chance. What a goal!
There was one new Liverpool colleague for whom the name Kenny Dalglish brought back embarrassing memories. In 1976, and Ray Clements was about to experience the ultimate in goalkeeping indignity.
Jordan getting it across. Dalglish. And it's a goal!
As Gordon Banks will be remembered for that magnificent save from Pelé in the 70 World Cup, I will obviously be remembered when I finish for the Kenny Dalglish goal at Hampden Park. My memories of that are obviously that there appeared to be no apparent danger and the ball was played in to the England penalty area around the penalty spot, and it came to Kenny, and he obviously tried the first time shot but mishit it completely, and it was straight at me. It was the sort of shots that I faced from sort of 15 year olds when I was at school. So easy to save, and because it was so easy, I didn't do the professional thing. I put my body behind the ball, went down to collect it with my legs open. And as every Scotsman will know, to their delight, and every Englishman to their horror, slipped through my hands, through my legs, and just about trickled over the line. And of course, if that wasn't bad enough, we actually lost the game 2-1 thanks to my mistake.
I never had it too well, but I aimed for Clem's weakness. No, it was just luck, really. It was, he was unlucky, went through his legs and just crawled over the line.
We've had one or two laughs about it in the early days, and I mean, he's always got that against me. If ever we get into a situation where we're taking the mickey out of each other, at the end of the day, he could always throw that in at me, and I'm finished. I've got no answer to it.
And here's Dalglish. Over his head nicely, and De Kubber was there, but so is Saunders there. Will he get a shot in? Now Dalglish! Across the face of the goal! It's
there, Dalglish! Wembley 1978, and the goal of pure genius which won Dalglish's first European Cup medal. Liverpool beating Bruges 1-0 in the final. This side went on to dominate English and European football for the next 6 years.
Liverpool probing forward again, and Dalglish has made space for himself. And tried to curl it, and does! A great moment for a master craftsman. It's his 300th goal in senior club football for Celtic and Liverpool. And if anyone could find a way through a mass defence, it's Kenny Dalglish.
When I was a kid, just almost ready to sign for Manchester United, in those days they used to play a lot against Real Madrid. And even though the Madrid side were just on the way sort of out, the most complete player I ever saw and sort of my hero in those days was Di Stefano, the centre forward, who I thought, you know, he seemed to me he could do everything. You know, he scored goals, he could defend, he was good in the air, both feet, exciting to watch. And Kenny, I was going to say he's close to him, but he's probably on a par with him as far as I'm concerned. Now, for me, that's the highest compliment I could pay Kenny.
I've looked at him very, very closely, and sometimes people have said to me he lacks a yard in pace. But I said, but he's 10 yards quicker than anyone else upstairs in his mind. They used to say that about Bobby Moore as well, he lacked pace. But I've never really felt he lacked anything, and that's why I class him as a world-class player. He's got strength everywhere. He's very, very strong. He's sharp. He's got two great feet. He can score goals. He can create goals. He can play as a member of the team as well as an individual.
You've got to be a brilliant player to play the game simple. When I say simple, you know, a ball knocked to you and you've got to knock it first time. In your mind, you've already sussed out where everybody is in the park and you think, if the ball's going to come to me, I'm going to flick it there and go for the return. So his brain used to be working all the time.
Dalglish, good turn away from Holmes that time. Souness. Well, it's some shot to beat the England goalkeeper from that range. Johnston with a dummy from Dalglish for Lawrenson. Superb! Saw nothing wrong. 2-0, Dalglish.
When I first come into the side, he was the main man then, and he helped me along tremendously, and he gave me the confidence which I needed. And from then on, I was just making runs, and when he had the ball, I just knew the ball was going to come to me.
Lawrenson for Hodgson to run onto. It's away from Jones. Dalglish. Rush, 4-2, and there you see just why Ian Rush is feared so much.
Most players have their back to goal, you know they've got a favourite side and they're going to want to turn that way and they're going to want to shoot with a particular foot. But with Kenny, he's prepared to turn either way, he's prepared to knock it back into other people's path for shots, and you just cannot anticipate what he's going to do.
Rush. Dalglish against O'Reilly. Splendid turn. Clements in the way again, but Rush, and still Clements.
He was born with a gift, as far as I'm concerned. It's something you don't learn. You can improve certain aspects of your game, but Kenny Dalglish was born with a great gift. And that's something, I suppose, if you ask him to describe how he scored a goal or explain how he did something, he'll find it almost impossible. I do, and I know Kenny would as well. And he also, his brain, you can see he's 3-4 moves ahead of everyone else. And at times I've watched him play, and I've got frustrated for him because I know he's thinking ahead of other people.
If I were ever doing a coaching film, I would start up with Kennedy scoring a goal and then turning to the cameras and showing that lovely smile of his. I think he indicates that he enjoys the game and puts a lot into it and takes a lot of enjoyment from it as well, which is, after all, what the game's about.
He's not like me, you know, so I used to sort of retaliate a wee bit. Now, Kenny talks to a lot of players. I mean, you see the moaning on the pitch, but as I say, nobody understands what he's talking about anyway. But he just gets on and does it. And, of course, if you go back to a time when Kenny was dropped by Scotland, and at the same time, of course, Keegan was dropped by England. Bobby Robson had taken over. And Keegan came out and said something like, you know, I don't want to play for England again, you know, which I thought was absolutely stupid. Now Dalglish came out and said, well, I'm very disappointed. The only thing I could do is to go out, try my best, try and play well, and try and get back into the Scotland team. And, of course, that is the... he is a professional player. It was, of course, he did.
They all appreciate what an ambassador he's been for the game, and he really has. And it sometimes makes me laugh when I'm up in Scotland and I hear, hey, well, he didn't do it for Scotland. That's rhubarb. Just look at the goals he scored against Belgium. I mean, they will just go down in folklore of great, great goals for Scotland.
Dalglish is Archibald ahead of him. That's a good pass for Archibald. Back to Dalglish. And Scotland take a lead. Dalglish. That's a great turn by Dalglish. Chance now on for Scotland.
If you had a kiddie and you said you want to be a professional footballer, who could I model myself on? You'd say Kenny Dalglish.
His attitude is tremendous. Great professional. I couldn't really fault him on the field. You know, if I was a manager, he's the type of player. I mean, he would be the first name on the team sheet week after week.
I'll give you another insight to him. I came in one day, I was in the dressing room, he played great, and there he was washing his own boots down. Now, he could have given them to a kid and said, hey, son, get the boots clean there. But there he was, wiping the mud off his own boots and bubbling it away. Hey, daddy, all right, you know. And he scored a great goal one day in Anfield, a real magnificent goal, but it's come to him and he's gone there, sold, and then he's nipped in with that quick half yard of it when he's away from people, and he's gone, boom, battered it. I said, how did you do that? She said, close my eyes and hit it. I said, oh, shush. I said, tell me. She says, I did.
He's just a character, and you can see now, as the manager of Liverpool, that he's still the same sort of person, still bubbly, still full of jokes, and you can see why the atmosphere is so good at Anfield.
In 1985, Liverpool decided to change the pattern of decades. The idea of player-manager was adventurous at this level of the game, and Dalglish was an unexpected choice, yet possibly an inspired one. Their triumphs had been led by managers who were older and wiser than the norm. Shankly, Paisley, Fagan. For Dalglish at 34, this was the start of a new phase in his career, and his days as one of the lads were over. A rapid adjustment had to be made.
I think it was easier for the players to adjust to it than what it was for me, because I always enjoyed the dressing room banter and being part and parcel of the lads, and I always regarded myself as one of the lads. But unfortunately, when you become the manager, the lads themselves put up an invisible barrier between yourself and them. And it's to be expected. It was done when I was a player, to every manager that we had. Although you were friendly with them and cooperative with them and you tried your best with them, obviously, and you respected them. There's a little barrier there that they'll never pull down. My first priority here is to look after the first team. But as a manager, I don't think that's good enough. I think really I've got to get deeper in and get my sleeves rolled up a bit more and be a little bit more committed to the younger lads here. I think it's important for a club of this stature to have some kids who are born locally and who have come through the ranks. It's important for the club, it's also important for the fans. It gives them a chance to relate to local lads easier than it does if you keep buying someone. But at the same time, the lads who are local have got to prove that they're good enough.
Kenny's Kenny. He's got his own thoughts about the game, and I'm in the sidelines if he wants to talk about anything, Ned, but there's no way that you'd let him. He's running it and picking the teams and that, and if there's anything that might be lying as an obstacle in front of him, you might give him a bit of a warning for it and that, and he's his own man.
I think he'll do exceptionally well as a manager. See, he's got this thing again, which I don't know if Steam was like it to begin with, but, you know, he's got... People are a wee bit frightened of him. You know, he's got that... I'm not saying he's got that mystique yet. Maybe that will come, but at the moment, he growls at people and he makes people jump. And that with his knowledge, and that, the fact that he was such a great player, I mean, who can argue with him? You got to respect that.
As you know, in the past we've had the Dalglish silver, and you've got a nice full-grain leather upper on that as well. Very nice leather.
Nice, isn't it?
Yeah.
It's a shame I can't play.
But this is the star boot in the range for us.
Commerce plays a part in the life of a modern successful sportsman. The image of Kenny Dalglish is a highly marketable commodity, whether he's endorsing football boots or, much more improbably, branching out as an actor.
Speak to me, come on. Tell me that you're there. The first time, I don't want you to be in there, you know?
What?
Come on, just tell me I'm no good. Doesn't matter. Just tell me I'm no friggin' good.
Oh, wait a minute, man.
It's all been a dream. Nothing but a sudden dream.
And the dialogue becomes even more impenetrable as Dalglish plays his part in purveying brandy to the natives of Hong Kong.
Cheers.
Mm. XO,
but today the business is serious. This is match day, and the opponents, Manchester United. Match day tension mounts at Anfield. Games with Manchester United are always a little special, and there's a lot at stake in this one. But 12 miles away in Southport, it's just another day for a man who's seen it all before. For Kenny and Marina Dalglish, keeping football in the limelight away from children Paul, Kelly and Lindsay is all important.
Without a lot of their help. There's no way that I'd be in the position that I'm in just now. Although people maybe think it's a glamorous life, they had to go without a lot of things for the sake of my career, and they've done that. And really, it's towards them, you know, that you're very, very grateful for them. I've got a job of work to do here. I accept the fact that there's a certain amount of access that you've got to give to the media. But I think, really, your family is a private thing.
Pressure rolling. Got a swing? Want to give a swing to him?
I will.
One, two, three.
But they're getting a little bit older now. In fairness to themselves, it's enough for them to be a daughter or a son of a famous footballer. I think it's right that they've got to lead their own lives now, and they've got to get on and be accepted for who they are, not for who their father is.
The big game doesn't only affect the players. While outside the turnstiles click frantically, behind the scenes, preparations to please board members, sponsors and guests, as well as coping with the sell-out crowd, stretch even Anfield's resources. And it isn't just on the field of play that Liverpool Football Club strives for perfection. The fans roll up for an afternoon of entertainment, excitement and tribalism, the blend at which football excels. But in the 1980s, the strengths which attract the masses are obliged to coexist with lunacy. As the United players arrive, someone fires an ammonia spray at them. Young Liverpool fans are also in the line of fire.
Come on.
It's the kind of nightmare incident which Liverpool, more than most, could do without. The visitors' dressing room becomes a first aid station, and United's Brian Robson stays on to assist the injured. Back to the real business of the afternoon, manager Dalglish has left himself out of the team, and the fans will not appreciate this act of self-sacrifice. Liverpool, says the conventional wisdom, are never quite the same when he's not in the park. Dalglish feels that a team being built for the future must learn to operate without him. This afternoon, his managerial priority after that unwelcome diversion is to keep things calm and light-hearted.
Hat, cap, scarf, or a badge, lads. Your souvenir club colours.
He's taken on a job that whoever took it would have found it difficult, but he's coped with it very, very well. I think he's had to make a decision whether he was going to play or whether he was going to manage. And I think he's opted, maybe sensibly and quietly, to opt out of playing too much. I think that's been a good point, because I think player-manager's job is almost impossible.
Obviously, he's in a difficult situation, particularly at Liverpool, where they have so many top-class players. But I'm sure Kenny, when we all get to that stage where the heart wants to do it, but the legs don't, you know, even if it's... And for someone as great as Kenny, even that few inches where you don't quite get there, you can't quite make it, is a big difference for a great player.
I believe he should keep playing until his legs give out, because you'll find that his playing days are his best days. And once you stop playing, that's when the worries start. Because as a player, I mean, you've only worried about yourself, really. And you can have a great game and a team lose and everybody still pats you on the back. But if you're a manager and the team loses, nobody comes and pats you on the back. So you're carrying a can for the whole of the club.
Who sent
the manager who slings the ball twice.
No,
I've got.
Oh, no.
Maybe not the lighter
one. Hey, I've just checked him.
Yeah.
the great players have not got a good record as far as managers come concerned. And let's hope he can. And you need a little bit of luck going along the line. It doesn't matter how good you are, and that things can go adrift, and you can get a couple of injuries in the right place, and then it's got you struggling and that. And but he's certainly got the knowledge to, you know, persevere with the player. And when I say persevere with players, and that, I think that was the failing of lots of the good players. They didn't have the patience. They just said, oh, he can't do that.
Try your best. If you're not good enough, you're not good enough. But I'd be the first to know if I wasn't going to be good enough. And I'd be the first to accept the fact that I wasn't good enough. And I've got the same attitude to this job as I had as a player. I'll try my very best, give them what I've got to give them, and just hope that I'm going to be successful.
For a spell, Manchester United push forward and their pressure is rewarded with a goal.
When you're losing, you don't want to give me in, you know. You want to keep going and hoping you're going to get a goal, maybe to equalise or two goals to get in front. People say that sometimes being a manager, your future is dependent on other people's mistakes or other people's brilliance. And as a player, I've always been like that anyway, because there's no one player who could go through and be successful himself. He needs the help of his teammates, and I've always had tremendous help throughout my career. As a manager, I'm just looking for the same help that he had from players in the past.
I couldn't see myself knowing what I could do on the field. And Kenny, I suppose, would be the same, knowing what he can do, watching players who maybe haven't got the same sort of ability or talent. Very, very frustrating. But to sit there and see people make mistakes has got to drive him nuts. I know it drives me nuts, just as a spectator. So that's another problem he's got to overcome.
I think he's got to change certain ways, but it's still come and talk to you. I think being a manager, if he stayed the way he is, most of all he wouldn't have got the respect that he needed as a manager. But now he's a manager, he has changed a few ways, but he's still his old self. He's still come training and he still talks to you. He's got the right mixture of being the manager and the player.
Training to win, and to win you've got to score goals. That's what you've worked all week for. And to see one get in, that's probably a relief as much as enjoying it or whatever you want to call it.
Some aspects of the job don't come naturally to Kenny Dalglish. Perhaps it comes from the Scottish background, where footballers tend to be seen and not heard. Interviewing Kenny, the press has long since concluded, can be a bit like drawing teeth, but he fulfills his responsibilities and they make the best of it.
What Kenny has got to come to terms with is that criticism, he didn't have much criticism as a player, but as a manager, you get criticism, and you get it from various quarters, and it's something that nobody likes, and it's very difficult to accept it. But it's something that, as a young manager, he has got to understand, come to terms with.
I think Eli's attitude and commitment was tremendous, really. Lauro's playing out of position, and he's
as good a game as anybody on the pitch.
The talk is football, but everyone here knows that the story of the day must be the pre-match incident. Dalglish does his best to talk only of the game, but next day the papers will say different.
Happy with the performance. We couldn't have asked for any more from any of the lads.
He's a nightmare for the press. I think Kenny, if you don't know him, can be a very awkward guy. But, I mean, he's a very private person. I mean, he's only got time for his family and people that he really knows. You know, he'd like to play the game of football and get into his car and go straight home and not have to talk to anybody afterwards. You've got to get to know him.
Kenny Dalglish took over as manager in the wake of Liverpool's darkest hour. The Heysel Stadium slaughter of the innocents before last year's European Cup final added a miserable new dimension to the club's affairs that it ill deserved. A reputation for good-natured zeal in the cause of football was suddenly replaced with the stigma of violence and death. Now Dalglish was to play a major part in the rebuilding of image while deprived of a European stage for his team to perform on. Cardiff 1985, and the goal that takes Scotland a step nearer the World Cup finals. But out of the celebration came grief, with the death right after the match of Jock Stein, the man who did so much to influence Kenny's career with Celtic and Scotland.
I was injured for the game, and I didn't fancy going to watch the game. It'd have been worse watching it than not being there at all if we weren't playing. And I went to watch another game at Ipswich that night, and I heard the result on the radio, but I also heard that Jock Stein had collapsed, and obviously we were hoping that everything would be alright. But when I phoned home, my wife had told me that he died, and really put into perspective football, there's no game that important that it causes somebody's life, really. But I think it was nice and it was in fitting, and I think Alec would agree as well that it was great for Jock Stein that the work he'd done for this World Cup had been seen through by the fact that Alas beat Australia to qualify.
About to make more football history by becoming the first Scot to play in four World Cup finals, an injury at Wembley forced Dalglish out of the Scottish squad on the very eve of their departure for Mexico. Now he will be confined to a television view of his country's progress in the finals rather than as a key participant.
All three World Cups, Scotland have been criticised really for not going further. But I think maybe we tend to forget the size of the nation we are. We're relatively small compared to a lot of other countries that are more successful than us. And I think when Scotland qualify for World Cup finals, I think that in itself is an achievement. Without giving anybody the impression that players regard that as being as successful as they want to be. Players go there and they want to be a lot more successful than what they were, obviously, just qualifying.
Glasgow once again salutes Kenny Dalglish. 15 years after his international debut, the Hampden Roar marks another milestone in this distinguished career. 100 appearances for his country and the presentation of a gold cap for his efforts. Romania will supply the opposition for this World Cup warm-up, but in the eyes of the 54,000 fans, this is Dalglish's night. But the crowd didn't realise it was probably his last appearance at Scotland's beloved Hampden.
Even the credit to the game, both on and off the field, as I say, because he's never been involved in anything unsavoury off the pitch, and any people who are looking for sponsorships or anything that's good for the game, your mind just springs to him.
Of course he'll go down alongside the great Bill Shankly, and Shanks was really did walk on water, and he's right up there with him, and that's the greatest compliment I can pay him.
Can Kenny Dalglish not leave me anything at all? I mean, he's got to take everything away from me. He's had more money, more caps, more goals. I mean, Abby's will. What am I going to leave to my children?
He's by far the most capped Scot in the game's history. Indeed, the most successful Scottish footballer of the lot.
Thank you.
There've been more spectacular players than him. If we're talking about an all-round footballer, there hasn't been a better one in my playing days. Maybe it's a schoolboy thing. I mean, think of Pelle and I think of Cruyff. Now, they were obviously tremendous players. I'm not saying he's better than them, but I'm saying he's better than Maradona. He's better than Rummenigge and better than Platini. In his best days at Liverpool, I would say he was the best player in the world, without any shadow of a doubt.
This year, Kenny Dalglish won the only medal that had eluded him in 18 years of professional football when he guided Liverpool to victory in the FA Cup final at Wembley. Yet another chapter in a remarkable story had been written about a man whose achievements and talents are known throughout the world.
Obviously, you can't go on forever. As long as I think that I'm capable of doing something, whether it's at first team level or reserve team level or what, I'll continue to play. When that time stops, I'll be the first to hold my hand up and pack it up.